What's up, guys? Welcome to Daily Dose of Reddit. This is your host, Zach, and today's subreddit is r/pro-revenge. Alright guys, this story's called, Want to undercut me on a job by doing shady and poor work? Fine, just wait and see. I was an observer in this whole affair, but to say I didn't enjoy the hell out of it would be a lie. Company A did fencing, walls, barriers, etc. Company A was ran by Bob. Bob was a real upstanding guy, took over the business from his father, and really grew it into something big. Bob had an employee, Jake. Jake had been with Company A for quite a few years, but Bob and Jake always rubbed off on each other in the wrong ways. Bob always felt like Jake was the king of shortcuts and shoddy workmanship. When Bob took over the company from his dad, Bob applied more pressure on Jake to bring up the quality of his work or be let go. Eventually, Jake got tired of the increased pressure and quit and formed his own fencing company called Company B. Derivative, here is where I come in. I started a job in a company providing business services to small to medium-sized businesses in the area, and both Company A and Company B became my clients. This was several years after Company B had formed. From my outside viewpoint, Company A was that local company that's been around forever that does good, quality work that you can trust, but they aren't going cheap. They never try to be cheap, but you can trust them. Company B was the young startup who was cutting corners and being competitive in every possible way, often by lying or misleading its customers. That's when Company C comes in. Company C was a building production facility in the area and wanted a wall with gates around its new production facility. This was going to be a big contract, and really the only two players in the area that could possibly do this job was Company A or Company B. This contract was worth a lot. If my memory serves me correctly, the job was somewhere near seven figures. Company A and Company B went to go bid. Company B came in at like a 30% lower price point, and even though Bob tried to explain it wasn't possible for Company B to do the work that was promised at the price point that was given, of course, money talks, and Company B got the contract. I remember Bob was furious. In his eyes, he felt what Jake was doing was wrong. He didn't mind fair competition, but Jake's MO has always been underbid, overpromise, or rely on cost overruns to make a profit. Bob's opinion on business was a price is a price, and if he says he's going X for Y, he's gonna do X for Y, even if he loses money. It's how he was raised. Some time goes by, and Bob gets a call from Company C. They've apparently fired Jake and his company due to not being able to do the work required, and ask Bob if he can come in and fix the mistakes. Bob agrees and gets the job done. At this point, Bob starts thinking, he's gotta take Jake out. Jake is taking too much money out of his pocket. Bob comes up with the idea of buying Jake out. But Bob knows if he approaches Jake, regardless of what he offers to pay, Jake is gonna say no. So Bob has gotta be smart. Bob is talking about this during one of our meetings. We had become quite close, and I tell Bob, I bet there are lawyers out there who specialize in helping other companies acquire other companies. Bob asked me if I know any. I don't, but I did have a client who specialized in business law who would be more familiar with this whole thing. I give Bob his contact info, and Bob thanks me. Bob contacts the lawyer and tells the lawyer what he would like to do. The lawyer tells Bob a lawyer who used to work for him now works for a firm that specializes in mergers and acquisitions. And if Bob wanted to buy out Jake's company, he's confident this firm could get it done. Also, this firm was in the big city, far away from their small community, so it's unlikely Jake would know what's truly going on. Bob contacts the firm and says he wants to buy out his competitor and would like to enlist their services. Now, this is already getting a bit longer, so I'll get to the point. The firm ended up buying Jake's company, lock, stock, and barrel, and gave the company to Bob. All the while, Jake was completely oblivious to the fact that his archenemy has just acquired his very own company. I recall Bob describing to me the day he walked into Jake's company with such delight. Bob was told he owned the company, Jake had been paid and was expecting to meet the new owner of the company that pleasant Monday morning. Jake was given the title of general manager and was considered second in command. man now. So, Bob walked into that building that once belonged to Jake with his documents and the lawyer that helped him acquire the firm, who Jake was familiar with. Bob walked into Jake's office. To Jake's surprise, Jake says,
"Hi, Bob."
"Hi, Jake. How are you?"
"I'm good. What are you doing here?"
"Oh, nothing much. Just thought I'd come check out my newly acquired business."
"Huh?"
"Jake, you sold your company to me."
"I did what? No, I didn't. I sold it to XYZ.
XYZ is the law firm I hired to organize the transaction. I am now the owner."
"That's bullcrap."
"Here's the documents."
Lawyer, who Jake was familiar with, confirmed this was all true.
"So now you're my boss?"
"Yes, now get up. That's my chair and I'm tired. I want to sit down for a minute."
"This is my office."
"This is my company and I have decided that this office is now my office. So I'm gonna need you to get out of my chair."
Jake gets out of the chair.
"Great. Well, have a seat, Jake."
"Thanks."
"Jake, I think the first order of business today is getting rid of redundancies."
"What do you mean?"
"Well, you see, Jake, whenever a company acquires another company, you get overlap, redundancies. 2 HR departments, 2 secretaries, 2 accountants, etc. But now it's all one company, so now you got redundancies, overlaps, which is quite frankly a waste of money."
"Yeah?"
"And I don't need 2 owners working for one company."
And he laughs and tells me he had the biggest crap-eating grin on his face.
"Jake, it's become apparent that your services are no longer required and effective immediately. You are terminated."
"But no, you can't fire me. I built this company from the ground."
"The decision is final. You may collect your personal belongings and leave the premises. What time did you get to work this morning?"
7 a.m.
"Great. So you've been here for 2 hours. I'll make sure payroll pays you out for 2 hours on the agreed upon rate in the buyout agreement. Have a nice day."
"So you're just firing me? Just like that?"
"Yep. Should have done this long ago."
"What about my family?"
"Jake, I just bought your company from you and paid you a lot of money. You'll be fine. Now get out of my office and out of my building."
And that is how Bob acquired and fired an employee he should have fired long before. And some background. I remember the day vividly when Bob scheduled an appointment with me to go over Company B services and negotiate a new service contract with us. It was the day Bob had fired Jake. Bob was in a great mood, one of the best moods ever. We did the business that we needed to handle, and Bob said,
"OP, you helped me a lot get this all done. I'd like to invite you out to dinner and drinks, and let's watch Monday Night Football together."
I really hadn't helped. And I said, "Bob, I really didn't do much." He said,
"Oh yes, you did. You pointed me in the right direction."
I go, "Well, that's the least I could do."
He said, "Very well. I still like to take you out to dinner and drinks if that's all right with you."
Now, I'm not one to turn down free beer and food, so I agreed. And that night, Bob and I went to a local hangout and watched Monday Night Football and ate and drank beer as Bob recounted this whole experience with such joy. Now, these are the kinds of stories we like to hear about when it comes to business acquisitions and stuff. The honest, hardworking guy wins in the end. That's a good ending right there. I give it the rating of pretty damn good. Pretty damn good. This story is called "Boss Blocks My Promotion, I Block His Job." For background, I work in a very competitive part of the service industry. It's a large enough community, but at the same time, it's small enough where someone somewhere in the industry knows you. So it's important to not burn bridges, as one day you might find yourself in a disadvantageous position. I was in my position for a good 3 years as middle management. No callouts, never late, always stayed after to help my team out. I worked on projects that belonged to my bosses, etc. Except for one day, which I had gotten in a car accident. I was working the night shift and it was raining, this is important later in the story, and was unable to go into work as my car was undrivable and I had to wait for a tow truck. Insurance and trying to find a ride late night, early morning was very difficult. At the time, my director had been let go and there was a bloodbath pissing contest to see who would get his promotion. For hierarchy purposes, it's my director, my direct bosses all on the same level of authority, 3 of them, then me. One of the direct bosses, let's call him Dick, decided he was getting the promotion and started shaking our department.
restructuring projects, changing people's shifts, taking credit for other people's work. It was a real pain. About a few weeks of this, he had decided to switch me from morning shifts, which I had gotten due to my seniority in the team, into night shifts. I didn't make a stink because we were very short-handed, also important, and the team needed help as we had newer members who had children, and I understood how this could affect their life. Fast forward a few more weeks, and I get into the car accident, which made me call out. This didn't sit well with him, as I had made the team suffer because of my irresponsibility. LOL, what? I didn't think much of it since I knew it was stressful and people tend to say things they don't mean under stress. Soon after that, I met some higher-ups from another department. They offered me a job in a new venture the business was exploring. I was a good candidate because of my experience and work traits. Of course, I agreed, as this would be a promotion in position and salary. Plus, my network of contacts would put me in a position to grow even further. I went through a series of interviews, 3 in total, and I was given the opportunity to take the position. I signed my paperwork and shook the hand. A couple of days later, HR called me saying the position was rescinded and that it shouldn't come as a surprise. I was shocked and asked for a meeting to understand the decision. Cue the day of the meeting. I walked in and HR is sitting in the meeting room with Dick. After the cordialities, Dick explains that he blocked my promotion because I had attendance issues, which I had one call out due to my accident, and HR chimed in saying this shouldn't deter me from applying again in 6 months. Okay, I accepted defeat because I still needed my job and I didn't want to paint a target on my back. A couple of days later, a friend of mine that worked close to Dick had told me Dick had made the comment that he didn't want to let me go because I would leave the night shift uncovered, and no one would easily accept that shift. I was furious, but decided not to act on it. As I explained earlier, it's a small enough business. A few months later, the competition opened up close enough that a few people left to go there. I was one of them. I was hired by an amazing boss who I am still friends with years after. He offered me a great position and a huge raise in salary. For hierarchy purposes, it was my boss, then me and counterpart, then our assistants. I had heard through the grapevine that Dick had gotten rejected from the director position and was leaving the company. About a week or so later, I was looking at new hires with my boss to fill out my counterpart position. My boss calls me and says, "Hey, look, this guy comes from the company you came from." To my delight, I saw Dick's name. I had been hiring people to the assistant positions from the previous company, so I guess Dick thought he was next. I told my boss about Dick and how he had blocked my promotion. All my boss said was TBNT, or thank you but no thank you. We didn't even give him an interview. Looking back at it, we should have given him the interview and just said no. It would have made it sweeter. Like I said before, don't burn bridges if your industry is small. Ooh, I love a good callback, man. You know, I just noticed that you don't really see that in Reddit posts. This guy, he made that whole story and he made a callback to what he said in the beginning. See, you don't know where that was going. I thought it was just, a little tidbit of information, but then he made a callback. Holy crap, that's some good storytelling there. That must have been really, really satisfying. A bit of advice I've been given before that I don't necessarily agree with, but it honestly is kind of true. When I say I don't agree with it, I mean I don't agree with following what it is advised, but it is kind of true. That when you set expectations really high, you don't really get noticed for the most part, okay? Some bosses, some people will notice and acknowledge and reward that, but for the most part, people will just, that will just become the expectation. That will become your standard and not something that should be appreciated, which honestly really sucks because that encourages lazy behavior with some bits of, coolness as opposed to encouraging good behavior and good work ethic, which it sucks, but that's just how it be, man. Obviously, this holds true more with large companies as opposed to smaller mom and pop shops, but even then, you can still have some really crappy managers or people in charge, you know what I mean. Today I frizzled up by ripping a giant bong hit in an important departmental meeting. This tfuh happened 30 minutes ago and isn't my tfuh, but rather my colleague's. Delete if not allowed, it was too fantastic not to share. Once upon a time, a nearby department that shall not be named stopped caring about ethics and allowed the team leads to hire their old buddies from past jobs instead of hiring people who can actually do the job. This led to a particular team lead hiring a bunch of old bartending buddies and allowing those old bartending buddies to take liberties such as extra work from home days and extra flexibility on shifts. One of these buddies decided to seize the opportunity and make the most of it by working from home more and more frequently. It was eventually noticed that while this fellow was tuning into all the Skype meetings from home, no one ever saw or heard from him on the calls. While some wondered why, no one inquired, as this was, after all, a former bartender buddy of the team lead. Then one day, Buddy pushed his luck too far and forgot to mute his Skype while tuned into a regional work meeting. This was not just any regional meeting, however. This regional meeting was the department head of a very important sub-team of the larger global team Buddy was part of. Now, department head had traveled to visit this office from corporate office in another country and had a name that was common in his country of origin, but less common in the country he was visiting. As Buddy had worked for an international company with offices all over the world and a focus on diversity, one could not be blamed for believing that Buddy would be used to names from outside of his culture and respectful of cultural differences. This was not the case. Imagine the scene. The well-dressed department head is in the middle of giving an important presentation about upcoming changes that will affect this office. Three or four people who aren't in office have one person, Buddy, who is tuned in via Skype and is listening quietly, as are the 40 people in the room. Aside from the voice of the department head and the quiet sound of keyboards clicking as notes are taken, the room is silent. Cue Buddy and a gigantic bong rip. The room goes completely silent as everyone tries to identify where the 15 seconds of someone loudly hitting a bong is suddenly coming from. Buddy, completely unaware of the life-changing mistake he has just made, compounds the situation by speaking to someone else in the room with him at his house, where he's taking a meeting that should only be attended by authorized members of the company. Buddy doesn't just speak. Oh no. Not content with having screwed up this far, he exhales the bong grip and launches into a short, mocking monologue about the department head and the pronunciation of his name. The room is stunned in silence for almost a minute as Buddy carries on his comments to his unseen friend, destroying his career further with every word. Eventually, someone from Buddy's team has the presence of mind to mute Buddy's line and end the situation. But the damage has been done, and Buddy's career is, well and truly, screwed. So yeah, that happened. And Buddy, if you're reading this, you're a freaking idiot. Edit. Buddy's girlfriend also works here. She left the meeting abruptly and has returned an hour later with a crimson-faced Buddy in tow. No idea where he is now. Edit 2. Buddy's at his desk, working silently and shamefacedly. Edit 3. So apparently we're just gonna sweep this whole screw up under the rug. Wow. That is so freaking good. Wow. Buddy just got away with murder. What? How is that okay? Oh man, he must be a good worker or something, because goodness gracious. Now that I'm thinking about it, it is a big company, and for stuff like this, they tend to move slower with this kind of stuff. They're probably going through the paperwork to get him fired and replaced. Who knows, maybe he gets away with it. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit that bell to never miss an episode.